It's good to be here today once more. No, Brother Henry, it's not the chickpea. It's not the chikungunya. I think I braved it a little yesterday going outside here with a cold ear, Pastor Morgan, trying to match up with him. And I might have just picked up a little draught, as they say. And this hot and cold climate that we've been having, today it's warm and the next day it's too cold. And I realize, sir, that I've been saying all week that we have limitations. And I think it's just a touch of the flu somewhere there. And I know that your prayers have gone up, and I'm thankful to God that we are here today and we are going to listen to the Lord, and He will use me. I invite you then, today is not going to be very long. What time is it? It's 12:15, somewhere there. 12:17 on the clock. Is that clock right, Brother Morgan? Yes. All right. Let us turn our Bibles to St. John chapter 9. We're just going to read a few verses there. St. John chapter 9. We read from verse 1. As he went along, he saw a blind man from birth. Or a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus. "But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent." We must do the work of him who sent me. "Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground, made some clay with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging ask, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes open?" they demanded. He replied, "The man they called Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash, and I went and washed. And then I could see." This is the word of God.
Amen.
Your time will come is my topic for today. Very simple, and very quickly we will just, I really just want to talk today. Just talk to you. Just really want to talk to you today. One of my main points during the time of the revival was that we all have limitations, and that is all right with God. But what is not all right with God is when we allow our limitations to limit what God can do with us or through us. And I continue somehow in that vein. Because things are not always wonderful in our lives. Bad things happen to us sometimes. And that makes us wonder why. We tend to ask ourselves, why me? Why? But if we just pause for a while, and this is what we fail to do sometimes when we are going through difficult circumstances. If we just pause for a while and look around, we will notice that there are worse situations around. People who have greater problems. And many times, they are happier than we are. Have you ever just spoken to somebody and just tell them some problems that you're going through, and when they turn up and tell you their problems, you said, man, I'm not even trying. And because of these issues sometimes, we become so overwhelmed with these challenges to the point where we fail to give God the glory that is due to Him. We allow ourselves to be shut down to the point where we forget God. And that is one of the things that I've been saying all week. When you look at God in light of your problems, you will see that your problem is not as big as they seem. We allow them to overwhelm us. I called a friend, pastor, somebody you know in Maryland just Tuesday or so. And I said, how are you doing? And she said, I'm blessed. I'm blessed, Brother James. But a lot of things have happened in my life. And I said, like what? And she said, let me give you a little of what I've been through since about February, March this year. My son went to school. He's in college and he's on the football team. And one evening, we got a call that he has injured himself very badly and had to be rushed to the hospital. When I got there, we realized he had a great operation to do to fix that situation. And it was going to cost us thousands of dollars. This school would not help. And we had to take on the challenge. And we had to go through all of that because he was in college. We wanted to get him back in school as quickly as possible. So during the course of March, April, he had gone through the operation. And then sometimes in April, I got a call that my mother was sick and was admitted in the hospital. We went to look for her. We realized that she didn't look very well at all. And so, Mother's Day, we got together to go to look for her in the hospital. Just as we were on our way, we got a call on Mother's Day that she passed. A few weeks later, she got a call that her 29-year-old daughter, who was in college, in nursing school in Florida, just was walking around and she just fell on the ground and couldn't get up. And they rushed her to the hospital. She was in touch with the hospital. And when the situation wasn't getting better. She wasn't coming out. It seemed like a simple fall. But she wasn't coming out of the hospital. She got down there and a number of tests were done and they couldn't seem to find out what the problem was. She took her back to Maryland to stay with her and took her to her doctor and to the hospital. Only to discover that she was diagnosed with MS. In an advanced situation. She said, I've got to pack up everything she had in Florida, what I could take home, some of the furniture. I don't even know what happened. Her boyfriend, who was living with her, just took the furniture and just moved out everything and hasn't even called. She said she took her home and started taking care of her. Then she went to work and she just felt her fingers cramping up and she just having this pain in her neck and she couldn't understand and her fingers were numb. And she went to the doctor and the doctor told her, and we're talking about August now, that something was wrong and some disc in her neck was pressing on some nerves. And she needed to do some corrective surgery to fix that. And had to be done very quickly. She went to the hospital and she got her surgery done. And she has a son to worry about. Her mother has just passed on. Her daughter is now home and she has to care for her for the rest of her life. And now she has an operation to do. And the funds have run out. But she went ahead and she got her operation done. She came back. They told her what to do to stay intact so that she would not aggravate the injury and whatever the situation is. So she was home, and her daughter was home one day, just about 2 weeks ago. And she went upstairs, just talked to her, and then she heard a heavy bang, like on the floor, and a loud scream from her daughter. And she said, "What's going on?" And she got out of her room upstairs and about to enter her room when she fell. She tripped on the ground and fell down from the top of the stairs all the way down to the bottom with her bad neck. She could move. Her daughter with MS fell in the bathroom and could not get up. And she is on the ground and cannot get up. She called her husband, and he entered. He came very quickly. And he had to take her up, then take up her daughter, get her dressed, and they both, and he rushed both of them to the hospital. She said, "Thank God my neck was not hurt up in any way, but I had bruises on my face, and my chest, my shoulder, and I was pained all over." And her daughter stayed for a little while in the hospital and was sent home. I listened to her. And I said to you, to her, "My friend, talk to me. How are you?" She knows I wasn't asked about her injuries. "Just how do you feel now in your mind?" And she said to me, "I am just praising God." I said, "Say that again." She said, "I am giving God the praise." I said, "Why?" She said, "God has been good to me." I said, "Amen." She remembers God's blessings. And she said, "In spite of what I'm going through, it will not stop me from praising God, because I remember how good God has been to me." And today I ask you, has God done anything for you lately? Has God done anything good, anything for you lately, that in spite of challenges you can still praise God? Paul said, "I can glory in tribulation."
Yes. Yeah.
Can we? Wow. This passage is about a man who was born blind. His dismal condition made things worse because the people around him, the friends he wanted, there was a serious stigma that was attached to him. Even the very disciples summed it up, like most of the Jews in their days, that sin was the primary, if not exclusive, cause for sufferings like these. He needed a friend, but instead everybody turned against him. The man could not help himself. He was treated like an outcast. Nobody cared much about him. And those whom he begged would sometimes turn away because this man was cursed. That's why he was born blind. Somebody's family had sinned or something. So viewed by many as helpless and hopeless, especially hopeless, this man could have easily just believed in his heart that he was hopeless. You know, people have reached that point in their lives. They listen to people and say, "You're a nobody. You're a bum. You're not going to reach anywhere." And eventually believed it. And some kill themselves.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. My God.
As if there is no hope for me. He could have believed it and just gave up. But somehow this man believed that something was going to happen. It seemed as if he probably didn't know all he wanted to know about Jesus, but must have heard about him.
Yeah.
And was hoping that his day would come when he met Jesus Christ face to face. face, he couldn't see him, but somehow he must have thought that my time is coming. This Jesus is around the place and he's going to pass my way someday. I ask you, do you think that sometimes Christ is just right there and you need to call upon him? He never gave up hope. He sat there and all he could do was beg, and he begged. But something tells me that he kept believing. And while he was there one day begging, all of a sudden, this Jesus turned upon the scene.
Yes.
Wow. The Christ. I said, when Jesus turns up, it is a completely different situation.
Yes. Yes.
Verse 5 said, when Jesus came, he said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world.
Amen.
A man is in a dark world. He's blind. He is suffering. His life was like darkness all around him. And all of a sudden, the light of the world turned up. Wow. And you know, Pastor, Jesus does seem to love situations like these. He seemed to just love these situations. Poor, suffering people seem to be his favorite.
Yes.
Some writer said, heartaches and broken pieces, ruined lives of why he died. Yeah. Oh, I know myself, and we talked about it, Pastor and I. When we look back at our lives way back, we weren't designed to be where we are today, based on circumstances. But the cross makes a difference
Praise
in our
God.
Lives.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
The cross makes a difference in our lives. And now Jesus took over. And when he came in, immediately the disciples asking this question, who sinned? The man or somebody in his family? His parents? Why the man was born blind? Because even the disciples believed that something had to have been wrong. Why this man was born blind. And Jesus dispelled it quickly. He dispelled the negative thought that it was as a result of sin where the man was born blind or in his situation. And there is no curse upon him. Sometimes we believe and blame ourselves for some of the circumstances that we experience. But the man believed his time would come. And I would like to say to you that if you are here today and you're going through some circumstances, trust me, your time will come. It's all up to you as to what you doing during this time. Jesus said, neither had this man sinned nor his parents, but that what? The works of God should be made manifest in him.
Yes.
Having said that, my friends, one thing you must figure out for yourself, or let us just look at it, Jesus knew that the man was there.
Oh,
yes.
He knew that the man was in a situation.
Mm-hmm.
He knew the situation, but the time had to come. You see, God works in perfect timing.
Yeah.
And sometimes we get impatient with God. Sometimes we get impatient with him. For not only is Jesus the light of the world, but he is the answer to all our problems. And very soon, he was going to work a miracle in the life of this man to show to all those around him that he solves problems. But just at the point when it seemed as if all hope was gone, just when it seemed as if there was no light at the end of this man's life's tunnel, the light of the world turned up. I am the light, Jesus said.
Yeah.
What a news that must have been for this man. I ask you though, is there something in our lives that already make us feel as if I will never ever get out of it? You've tried hard to fix it on your own and it has worked. Jesus is saying, it's not your job. I am the way.
Yes.
It's not your job to fix it. It is not your job. The blind man, his situation was beyond medical science at the time. Nobody could figure out why the man was born blind. And you know, we moved on way above those times, we could say. But they couldn't figure it out. They couldn't understand it. It was beyond their medical ability to even come up with answers as to why this man was born blind. And not only that, they had never seen a man born blind seen. Never happened. And so you understand that this man was hopeless. Totally hopeless. And that is what I've been saying all week. There are some things in our lives that only God can fix. And until we get that, we will live a miserable life until we die miserably. Because some things in our lives cannot be fixed but God. Only God can handle it. I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus said. He answered them and he said, this man didn't do anything wrong, but that the works of God might be manifest in him. Yes. Oh God, I wonder if there is something happening to somebody today. And God has known about it, but he is waiting on you to surrender, that his works might be manifest in you. I wonder today, are we going to continue to try to fix our own selves? Sometimes you tell somebody, come to church, come and let us pray for you. And they're telling you that I have some things in my life to fix first. And some are some huge things, like getting married and getting a house and all of that. I don't want to come and go back out, because you think what you're doing, you have to go back out for it. Let me tell you something. God is able to save and to keep and to satisfy.
Amen.
Oh, yes.
Yes, sir.
You're thinking about your own strength. When you come to God, he gives you strength.
Yes.
He takes over. In the case of this blind man, Jesus must have passed him by a few times. And seen him, he knew about him, but he has a plan. God has a plan for you. But you keep holding your life in your own hands. He has a plan, and your time will come.
Yes.
It might not have been yesterday. It could be today.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Today. Isaiah wrote in Isaiah chapter 40, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The fact is, to wait upon the Lord is not to sit by and relax and believe that something is going to happen. It's to trust in God and serve him.
Amen.
Wait upon him like a waiter in a restaurant. Serve God and he will do what he has planned to do in your life. Most of the people in those days did not believe that Jesus was the Son of God. They did not believe that he was the promised Messiah and the Redeemer of mankind. But it was now time for Jesus to demonstrate who he really was.
Yes.
It was time. Mm-hmm. And sadly, many times God has brought us to a point in our lives where we actually see him and we turn our backs on him. So Jesus took the blind man. It was no time. His time has come after all the suffering. And Jesus sat there. And all his detractors were watching him. And he was about to show them who this Jesus is. And he sat there. And the scripture said, Jesus looked down into the dust on the ground. And he spit in it. Spit from his mouth in the dust. And he used his finger and he made some clay, some mud. Oh man, that doesn't look good. What is Jesus going to be doing with this dust and this spit? And when I was preparing this message, I got excited. Because all of a sudden, the Spirit brought me back to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. Do you want me to read that for you?
Yeah.
It said, and the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground.
Yes.
Hey, yes. Something is about to happen here. He formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed in him the breath of life, and he became a living soul. But when I look at it, I said, hold on. This Jesus seemed to know something about creation.
Amen.
He seemed to know something about creating mankind.
Oh, yes.
He's gone right back to the original raw material.
Yeah.
Dust. And I started to picture God making you and I. And he got some dust and whatever he had to it, but he formed it up, and he said he formed man. But he was only man. He was nothing. But then he breathed into him the breath of life. And what happened? He became a living soul. Take away the breath. Man is nothing but a piece of clay somewhere rolled up with the spots in his face like eyes and nose. Take away the breath. And that is nothing. That's who we are. And some of us believe that we can live as we please. And look at God just taking some dust. And just, it was when he breathed into us. It's like a fraction of himself he placed in us. His DNA, if you wish. My God. And we became a living soul. And this Jesus, around with all his detractors around him, including his followers, and he went back to the same dust. And he sat down. You see, my friends, this man born without eyes. He was born blind, but in a sense, he had no eyes. And Jesus was about to create a pair of eyes for the man. He went back to the same material. He took it up and he put it there. And he spit. Why spit? I don't know. But I think it was his DNA going into that piece of creation. And he made some paste and he played around in it. And he called the little man. And he took up the mud with the spit. And he just put it exactly where the eyes were, and then paste it around there. Look at Christ creating a pair of eyes. Just look at Jesus. And he put it right there. And I'm sure that boy, if I was there, I'd be... Man, that's yucky. Man, that looks disgusting. Remember Brother Henry.
Oh, yeah.
This same Jesus had healed many people before.
Right.
He looked at them and he said, open your eyes, and the eyes were open.
Oh, yeah.
He looked at the devil and he said, speak, and they spoke. He looked at the man on the ground who was crippled and he said, get up, take up your bed and walk. There was a time when somebody said, Lord, I have a sick at home. And he said, take me. He said, no, you're greater than that. You don't have to come to my home. You are greater. Speak the word and he shall be healed.
Yes.
And he spoke and the man was healed. Oh,
yes. Amen.
Hey, you said Lazarus. He was in the tomb 4 days. He said, come out. And the man came alive.
Yes.
This time it was not a healing. It was a creation of two eyes. He was making it right there with the same dust. And some of the things he was demonstrating was that you guys who are calling me all kinds of names, look at where you come from. Look how I make you. Jesus Christ. And he placed it on. And he said, go wash in the pool of Siloam.
Yes.
The pool of Siloam had no healing power.
Yes.
It was not so much washing in the pool of Siloam, but it was the obedience of the man.
Yes.
Jesus was sending the message that if you listen and believe and obey me, things will happen in your life. Go wash. The man said, I went and I washed and I came back seeing you. Wow. Listen to me, friends. Your time will come. And the same God that has done all of these miracles is able to do them today. He has done it before. He can do it again. He has not lost his power.
Amen.
He is God. He is unchangeable. He is untouchable. He is God, unshakable. And he's able to do it again.
Yes.
The problem with us is that we want to fix it ourselves. And God has a specific time and a specific work to do in you. But we can't hand it over because of pride and whatever it is getting in the way. And I'm saying that it can be done. Your time might have come today. Will you trust God today? You know, I won't go no further here. I'm just saying today, God has created two eyes out of the mud he spit. What can God do for you today? As Christians, sometimes we need a new pair of eyes, Brother Morbidge. We're not seeing what God is telling us, is showing us. We're not going where he's leading us. And sometimes we're going to have to give up our pride. The mud and the spit in our eyes never look good. But sometimes God has to bring us to that place. Humble us.
Yes.
Take up that mud from the ground and wipe it on your eyes. And get you to understand that it is the Lord God Almighty who is in charge and not us. And then he's asking you to be washed, but not in the pool of Siloam, but in the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what is missing from our lives. Fixing our own selves, fixing our own problems. When God is saying, I am right here. The songwriter said, he is no further than a thought away. When you speak to him, he always hears. For he's always near. If this blind man who was born without eyes could have received two brand new pair of eyes, what can God do for you today?
My Lord.
Has your time come? Bow your hands with me.